Thank you so much for your introduction. Hello and good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the afternoon session. Usually these sessions after lunch are pretty interesting, so I'll try to see if I can keep things rolling and, like, you know, make things interesting as we go by. So just to basically, again, like, you know, I have been introduced already, so just to say, introduce again, I'm Gaurav Banerjee. I'm the director for advanced analytics, and I also head the data science practices with Harman Connected Services. So the topic of my discussion today is where I want to, like, you know, kind of present to you what we call as, like, you know, customer journey through analytics, or we call it, like, you know, interdependencies of analytical solutions or what have you. So basically the point what I'll be trying to make over here is or showcase is how analytics has evolved. And I'll also be presenting, like, you know, what I mean by the word evolution, because again, the evolution of analytics could also, like, you know, it's a pretty cliche term now, and I'll try to, like, you know, do my best to kind of clear through the haze and, like, you know, make some clarity about that. And when I'm doing that, I'll also, like, you know, try to give you an idea as to why the landscape is changing, how is it changing, what is the implications of that, and how do we manage those challenges of the changing landscape. So, again, when we say analytics has reached a maturity phase, again, you would have heard this term a lot. And if you've been in the business for as long as I have been, one thing remains constant is analytics as a word, as a term, has been highly misused and abused in the industry. People use the word analytics in whatever manner they would want to do, want to choose to. And hence, when I show you this, the first line over here, when I say analytics or data science has reached maturity phase, what I mean by that is, again, when I look back upon my experiences when I had started in the industry many moons back, the way it would happen would the business managers or the business guys would come to the data scientists. They say, you know what, we have this problem. What can you do for it? So data scientists would go beg, borrow, steal all the whatever data he could, scrape through it, get the data. Run some analytics, maybe regression, logistic, whatever, depend on whatever that might be. Come back to the business manager again. Both the manager and the data scientist would huddle into a room, and then they would start, like, you know, discussing the impact of R square. What does R square mean for me? What does it do? It's like, is it really meaningful? Should I be worried? And then they would decide, you know what? Yeah, this is good finding, but we need some more additional bit of information. So the cycle would start all over again. The data scientists will go back, again, get some additional pieces of data, do some another analytics, come back, do the same discussion, and the whole process keeps repeating. The problem with that, it was fine, say, 15 years back, even 10 years back, 5 years back, because speed was not, because analytics was a thing which was not as widely used. So people who were using some form of analytics had the luxury to wait or to go in this repeated cycles of development. Unfortunately, that is not the case anymore. Those dynamics, those situations have changed. So now the analytics is no longer a tool for decision making, but it is a part of a solution. There has been a significant shift or the transition of how the application of data science from just being a supporter or, like, you know, an assistant to provide decision making, it has become a part of the solution. And the moment something becomes a part of the solution, obviously, like, you know, you increase your speed, you reduce your cycle times, and your reach to the market is pretty, pretty fast. Now, what that does is it changes or it forces us to change the whole approach to the how do we tackle a problem. So it is, like, you know, looking from more from a data perspective, it is now looking at much more from a solution perspective, so that you are providing a solution which the business manager can take and take actions upon immediately. And also, like, you know, once you change the approach to it, now there has been a very dramatic blurring in the competencies required to the person, like, you know, now we call as a traditional data scientist. Is it like, is he a statistician? Is he a machine learning guy? Is he an optimization guy? Who is the person? So now the differences have blurred quite dramatically. while this change was happening, and these are the typical business questions that usually come in on any kind of industry, irrespective of what domain you are in, these are usually the kind of questions which remain static. Like, and who are my customers? Do we really understand the customers? Who are our most profitable customers? How do we control churn or customer attrition? How do we increase the depth of relationship, cross-sell, upsell? How fast we can roll out new products? How do we manage and adapt with changing technologies? So these are the typical questions that you would, like, you know, if you are a practitioner in this area, would basically, you know, you would face on a regular basis. The questions have remained same over the years. The questions have not changed. How do you do your business, or rather what you need to do your business has not changed, but how you do your business has changed. Why? Because the answers that you were looking for earlier, or the answers that they were earlier, were basically maybe from a very static one or two databases that would come out and you would just do the analysis and that was the end of it. However, nowadays that answer lies hidden in a plethora of data. The data could be like, you know, internal to the organization, it could be external to the organization, it could be structured, it could be unstructured. So when I say unstructured, like, it could be like now you have like a presence in online presence, so you have clickstream data, you have social media data, you have obviously you have your internal to organization, like, you know, transaction data, billing data, so on and so forth. So data is out there and it's huge. It's coming from all different sources. So the variety of the data that is being presented for analysis to find one answer has exploded. So with this tectonic shift in the scope and the depth of information available, we have something called now a single view of customer. So now again the question, it begs to question is, like, now there are so many terms, so many jargons in the industry. Is single view of the customer also another jargon? Is that what it is? The major difference has been the technology that has come in the play is a major game changer. Why? Because earlier, taking case of example of a retailer, you would have one brick and mortar store, you would put your best people there, you manage your experiences there, and that was the end of it. So you were pretty confident of, like, you know, your experiences, your interactions with your client. However, with now multimodality, clients can interact online, interact with you over your mobile. Those dynamics have changed. So what happens is, or the organization has to manage those experiences across those different modalities. To give you a very another example, not necessarily of modality, but like, you know, how to break down the silos. A good example would be your any telecom provider. So now, take for example Airtel. They would have your broadband services, they would have your landline services, and they will also provide cell phone services. If the customer is not tracked uniformly and coherently through all different services jointly, what happens is, if my experiences with broadband is like, you know, I'm not too happy with it, I may decide to move all my business to some other provider. So now, the mobile provider or the landline provider, they are left wondering as to why this customer, supposedly good on the paper, just simply moved. That is example of this basically the multimodality thing. And other thing is, there's very high competitive pressure. If you don't do it, somebody else would. And this is true from the client side as well as the provider side. From a client side, if you don't capture or the corner the customer, your competitor would. From a vendor perspective, you don't have that single view of customer as a solution in your portfolio. Your competitors would. And guess who wins the game then? So in next few slides, what I'm going to do is I'm going to demonstrate to you how the whole thing works. In the sense, over here what I have is a very simple model or the activities that a typical CRM department takes. So for a CRM department, there are four of the key initiatives, key activities that they have to take. They have to acquire the customer, engage him, retain him, and increase the depth of relationship or loyalty. Typically, there are four separate functions within an organization, each one of them responsible for their own part. So the acquisition team would be only be involved in or bothered with, like, you know, customer, the channel analysis, or like, you know, what's the cost of acquisition, so on and so forth. And these would be their metrics that they'll be targeting, or the objectives they'll be targeting for. Like the targeting prospect, profitable customers, increasing conversion rate, and so on and so forth. You would have other sub-units within the same department focused only on engagement. So they would have their own data sets. They would be, like, you know, talking about their own stuff, like segmentation, cross-sell, upsell, and so on and so forth. Same thing with retention. Like, you know, they would do all this, with attrition modeling or churn modeling, as we call it. And how is the, what is like, you know, your CRM response modeling, is all those things. And then finally, the loyalty. So loyalty guys would be involved in, like, you know, again, making sure how much profitable they can make a customer. So this has been the traditional way in the industry so far. So now when if we go back to, like, you know, what I had just presented, like, you know, the way analytics has evolved, the question remained the same. So for example, I want to say, I want to take, basically figure out or do basic churn prediction modeling. So now that would, in a technical traditional term, would fall with the retention subunits. And they would be using something like, you know, your logistics or some kind of classification algorithm. So now these are, you know, typical data scientists with background in statistics or whoever doing this thing. However, the solution or the question to this, that is being asked, is the impact of customer attrition on overall profitability. So just by doing this one thing really does not give you answer to that one, to that question. So again, that puts you in multiple loops of cycles to get you the right answer. When analytics or when data science is a part of a solution, these are all different activities that needs to be performed. So from if I'm doing churn prediction modeling, I also need to know the churn attribution analysis. Who are where exactly is the churn happening? When I'm doing that, I need to find out who are those customers who are churning. When I'm doing my segmentation, I also need to figure out where are those people are churning, where are they coming from. So that's my channel analysis. What was the amount I spent on, like, you know, acquiring them? And all of this ties up to my CLV assessment, which is nothing but your customer lifetime value. So, and this CLV assessment finally leads into your profitability analysis. So as you can see, just one solution spans across multiple business units and multiple specializations in a traditional sense of way. So the green boxes over here represent your BI or descriptive analytics, and the blue, dark blue box over here represents your optimization. Take another example, same, churn modeling. But the question this time has changed. So how to stem customer attrition to influence profitability? So that I need to understand, like, you know, if I want to retain my good customers, what kind of upsell, cross-sell that I need to do, what kind of promotion I need to give them for me to retain to them. That directly will lead back into what's my campaign response modeling. Maybe CSAT and, you know, the CSAT scores do have an influencing factor in basically, like, you know, increasing my cross-sell, upsell, which directly ties up to my increasing my loyalty and thereby increasing my profitability and again my lifetime value. So if I were to just look at the whole thing, just one question, churn modeling is actually nothing but amalgamation of all the different solution areas to answer one question: how can I reduce my churn, and how can I, like, you know, basically impact or influence my profitable customers from leaving me? The previous slide again touches back on the question. It's like, okay, if I have to do all those things, who are the people doing it? Are they big data guys? Are they BI guys? Are they predictive analytics guys? Who are those people? So this definition of a traditional, typical data scientist, as I had, like, you know, proposed earlier, has blurred dramatically. I do not know. So the person has to have some kind of a exposure or competency in almost every one of them, and then even some more. So these are some of my observations, like, that I would like to present and leave it with you. The bottom line is, the data science department or data science or data scientist, as we typically know, that is no longer true. That does not hold true anymore. So people, the data scientist has evolved into a person who has multi-specialty, multi-skills. So I would, like, you know, just propose over here that maybe specialization is dead, and it's the more of the area, like, you know, generation for generalization. The only, actually, I'll come to the last point first. So to meet our challenges, hiring is always an option, and it will always remain a challenge. There's always a competency risk. Like, you know, when you hire a new person, yeah, you have all the assessments and interviews and the skill assessment and everything, but at the end of the day, there's still an element of risk that you cannot completely avoid. That is not going away. The high cost of hiring, there's always a cost involved. Obviously, if you're picking up, like, you know, people from the market, and especially in the data science, they demand premium. So your cost, overall resource cost, goes up pretty high. And the third one is uptake time. So by the time you roll out an offer to the time the new resource becomes productive, could be anywhere between 2 months to 4 months, very easily. And by the time your urgency has, like, I don't know what has happened to your urgency. So the solution remains is, like, you know, the constant upskilling, cross-training is the need of the hour. You have your own resource pool, and take them and cross-train and upskill them. There was one presenter earlier in the morning session that had presented on the training plan, and one point that she was mentioning was the last one over here, that was, like, you know, just for me training programs, which is, like, much more business focused, business centric, and it focuses and targets what we require and ignores all the rest, and that is, I think, is the need of the hour. Also, another thing that we can do is, like, you know, give as much exposure to the resources as possible. It could be, exposure could be, like, you know, maybe rotating them through different business groups, or, like, you know, maybe even through different geographies, because if you, the exposure to different geographies is also very, very important. So in the end, just to recap, it's like today's business need is changing very fast, is very dynamic, even though the language or the articulation remains the same. So the questions that are being asked, they are remaining the same, but the way we are answering them, that is changing. Data scientists, as I have been trying to point out in this presentation, is, like, you know, they have to adapt to this changing requirement. And prediction is not independent of optimization. The churn example I showed you, there were components of optimization, there were components of, like, you know, descriptive analytics, there were components of predictive analytics. So it's a whole amalgamation of all different math science that has come together to provide an answer. Right coaching and approach towards the business cases is very critical. Cannot be, like, you know, I cannot stress more on the criticality of the coaching and the exposure. And again, organization need resources with good analytical quotient and business knowledge who can appreciate the interdependencies. So with this, I end my presentation. Any questions? You have a question?
Thanks, Gaurav, for this presentation. It was really helpful. So we were talking about data scientists. They should know all the components, like optimization, prediction, forecasting. But many a cases, what happens, you know, somehow they get lost in the techniques and algorithms and all the statistical modeling. And they actually forget the real essence of the business. They started with a business problem. And you should end up with a business solution with some good story. And that disconnect is becoming a lot more problem for the clients, that they are not able to actually appreciate these modeling techniques. So how do you see that? Do you see that only the right training is going to help them, or is this the, because business knowledge is something cannot come through training, right?
Yeah.
You need to actually go through the system. So how do you bridge that gap when you train somebody on techniques and all, but you can't use them to actually present in front of your client?
See, and that is the whole central theme of this talk. It's like you have to move away from technique. Yeah, technique is important, absolutely important. There's no work around it. But that technique should be put into context. That's one thing. And as you said, like a business exposure is something that is inherent, that comes with experience and exposure and all different other factors. Training does play a very important part in, say to say, like a, icing on the cake. If you have an internal like, you know, learning and development department, you can always rely back on them, develop the training programs. Or then there are other institutes out there who can always like pair up with your organizations and like, you know, provide you with the necessary training required. In fact, in my organization as well, the easiest way that I have found, or the most efficient way that I have found, is basically hire people who have exposure in an industry. But at the same time, they have acquired the basic understanding and knowledge of data science and other related sciences from other academies. So getting those people on board is a much faster way to the market, basically.
Right. So which approach would you prefer, or Harman preferred as an organization? Training people with 8 years experience in Harman, train them on data science, or hire a very smart data scientist which may not be having a lot background about the business, what is going to work for, because it hardly at times that you actually know that this person is going to work for this particular project, but you know what is going to come in terms of the requirement of that particular solution. So what is the Harman's approach in tackling this problem?
So you can never discount smart people. You have to always have smart people.
So I'm not saying they are not smart people.
But the way you can do this is you can actually, like, and that's why you have this team structures. That's why you have these hierarchies. And basically, like, you know, pair them up with people with experiences and exposures. And that's how you deal with it.
Okay, thanks.
So every year in the analytics world, we come across new jargons, new buzzwords. I think in the last few years, from analytics, analysts have become data scientists. And
yeah,
we've heard a lot about big data and IoT in the last few years. What do you think so are the new things that might be coming up, or that we have already begun to speak about but haven't really come into the limelight, that might be coming up in a big way in the years to come?
So a few things that you have mentioned, like, you know, big data and what we call is IoT. Now everybody these days has been talking about IoT. Developing a use case and getting a solution out there in the market, that in my opinion will take some time. There are, in fact, the presentation right before the lunch over here, where the gentleman was presenting on the sports data and stuff. In fact, there are companies out there that have sensors in their, the uniform or the sports dressing, especially in the American football, where it's much more of a contact game. So all those are basically derivatives of big data of your IoTs, in a way. So that's where it's going, and how it evolves, is that something for us to be seeing?